Hey guys, my name is Joanna, also known as Just Another Flutist here on YouTube, and I thought today I would talk about some of the realities of being a private music teacher that at least I wasn't really prepared for when I first got into this career. The stuff I'm about to talk about is not exactly the most positive, so you guys will probably be wondering why I still teach even though these realities exist about the career. So I thought I would just put a disclaimer out there that really in any industry you go into, there are going to be cons. There are going to be realities of your dream job that are not going to make it so dreamlike. But at least for me, you still keep going. You still keep doing what you're doing because in the long run, it's fulfilling for you. The act of teaching also fulfills others. And it's why I'm willing to put up with these realities. So with that being said, let's jump right into it. Number one, building a private music studio takes a really long time. And it's even worse when you don't play an instrument that is considered more popular. I am a professional flutist, so for me, this is very much a reality. Let's say one of my students is being forced to drop something from their schedule. Typically, they will drop flute lessons instead of piano lessons. That's sort of the reality of the situation. I do realize there are a lot of professional flutists out there. There are a lot of flutists out there in general of all different levels. If you were to put us all together, that would be a lot of people. However, in the grand scheme of things, if you compare the number of flutists there are out there in the world compared to how many people there are in the world, the fact remains that we are not a huge part of the population out there. On top of this, not everyone who asks about your lessons and how much you charge and how they work are actually interested in taking lessons from you. I have experienced many people from different churches that I've been to ask me about lessons, and when they ask me, they're very, very excited. They tell me that they're going to tell all their friends, and some of them even tell me that their child might even take lessons with me. I would say, for the most part, 80 to 90% of these inquiries never actually go through. I don't know why that is. I do not believe that I'm the only person who experiences this. My dad is a private counselor and he gets a lot of these inquiries as well for counseling. And it's the same. You get a lot more people inquiring than you have people actually taking you on. If we go a step further, for the people who do take you on, not all of them will actually continue with you in the long run. The way that I have dealt with this is to set up a trial lesson. My trial lessons are 1 hour and they actually cost an additional $5. You might be wondering why that is. And for those of you who have been looking around for music lessons, you may have noticed that some teachers actually offer free trial lessons. The mentality goes both ways. If you offer a free trial lesson, you may get people trying you out as a teacher that you may not otherwise be able to get if your trial lesson was not free. It's a way to attract people to come study with you. However, for me, I found that since I am opening up my lessons to the internet, I teach on Skype and FaceTime, a lot of people end up abusing this idea of a trial lesson. They feel that they can just get a free lesson out of you and then they don't have to commit. What I'm looking for though are people who would commit to lessons. I'm basically filtering out my inquiries. Because they are willing to pay an extra $5, it makes me trust them more. That extra $5 just lets me know how much they actually want lessons. The second big thing is that there's no actual formula for teaching. What you'll find is that even if you use pretty much the same books for each student is going to react to those books differently. For example, I teach harmonics to each of my students out of page 6 of Trevor Wise's big tone book. So some of them pick it up really quickly. Others I need to work on a little bit more to see what it is that they're having trouble with. So you'll find that even though you may have your system in terms of what you want to teach at what pace, not every student is going to just 100% be able to go along with that. And you'll need to be flexible enough to figure out, you know, is it because they're not practicing or is it because there's actually something that you need to figure out and diagnose about how they're playing the flute that is preventing them from actually getting better. Building on top of this idea, the third big thing is that not every student is going to click with you. It doesn't matter how nice you are, it doesn't matter how renowned you are as a teacher, there are going to be some people that you just don't click with. And that's just a personality thing. On top of this, your personality may not click with the parents of your students. So I have had cases where I clicked really well with the student. The parent did not want to continue lessons, and the student tried every way she could to beg her mom to keep letting her study with me. So it was a no-go. The parent is the one paying for the lesson, and this child could not do anything about it. Even if you click really well with a student, it's still not a guarantee that that student is going to stay with you in the long run. So when you do get a student that you don't really click with, that's when you need to start asking yourself, do you drop them or do you keep them? The answer will vary from person to person. Let's say you have a lot of students, right? And then you come across one student that you just, after weeks and weeks of trying, you guys just don't click with each other at all. It would probably be more beneficial to both parties if you referred them to a different teacher. That way they can try out a different teacher who obviously has a different personality, may click with them better. Also, that time slot that you were teaching that student can be opened up for someone else who will probably actually click with you more. In a way, it may actually benefit a third party. However, let's say you don't have a lot of students. That's when you need to start asking yourself, do you just power through and try to get to know this person? Sometimes there are some people that it just takes a long time for you guys to get to know each other. And even if your personalities don't click very well, at the very least, you can grow to respect each other. Number four, I think, can be one of the most depressing things. There are some times during the year, every year, that you won't get paid. That's the reality. Because you're running your own studio, if your student gets sick or goes on vacation and they alert you ahead of time, there's no reason for them to pay you for hours that you're not teaching them, right? And so that means that when they are sick or on vacation, you're not gonna get paid. At the same time, if you take time off as a teacher or you get sick, you also won't get paid because that's not their fault, obviously, right? Summertime is the worst for this because everyone is traveling, including yourself. So you'll need to start planning ahead of time how you're going to deal with the summertime down months. For example, a lot of weddings happen in the summer. So you can try booking a lot of wedding gigs to make up for the predicted loss of income during those months. That's just one example. There are many other ways to go around it. But the idea is that you want to find some form of work that can supplement your income on your down months. So as you can see, making money as a teacher is not actually as predictable as it sounds. A lot of people already realize that as a musician, making money itself is already going to be an unpredictable thing. But the kind of wrong concept that a lot of people have is that, well, at least if you're a teacher and you get students all the time, then you will definitely have a stable income. But I'm here to say, from my experience of several years teaching now, that is not the case at all. It is just as unpredictable as being a musician who just does a lot of gigs. Your gigs are basically your students. I noticed that for myself, my income is the biggest around the fall and the spring. And I think this is because in the fall, a lot of people are starting up new seasons in their community band or their school band. And for the spring, a lot of people are preparing for exams or competitions. So in those months, that's when people start to freak out and want to find a teacher. In the winter and the summer, you don't get it as much because everyone's on vacation. This fifth reality I saved for the end because it is the most positive out of all of the realities. And it's simply that there are some times in your career along the way that you will need to make sweeping changes to the way your lessons work for everyone. For me, one of the big things was using OneNote. My boyfriend introduced OneNote to me a few years ago because he is actually a developer on OneNote. And I ended up using it for everything. I started using it to write notes for these videos, organizing my tax stuff. I used it for my diary. Then, of course, the natural next thing I started to use it for was to organize my notes for my students. In the beginning, I would just send these notes to my students via email, but then my boyfriend showed me how to share the notebooks with my students. I wasn't sure how on board everyone was going to be with that idea, so I ended up kind of doing a trial with one of my students for about a year before I ported everyone over. The act of porting everyone over was, on the one hand, more difficult than I expected it to be, and on another hand, also easier than I expected it to be. It was harder because I had to actually put reminders in my notes to remind them to open this shared notebook with them. Some people kept forgetting to open their notebook, so they didn't get their notes for like one or two lessons because they kept forgetting that we had switched to a new system. But at the same time, everyone was very receptive to it. So the reception was a lot easier than I expected, but the act of actually getting everyone used to it was a bit of a challenge. Another sweeping change that you will need to make are raises to your rates. Two reasons. One, it's because your rate should match the amount of experience you have. Someone who has a master's will charge more than someone who only has a bachelor's in music. Now, the other thing is that you also need to match inflation rates compared to what people are paying for their normal day-to-day things, and also compared to what other people in your area are charging for music lessons. You may need to raise your rates as the years go by, very, very slowly, just to kind of match it. Because you don't want to be caught in a situation where, let's say you start being paid $30 an hour because in that particular era, you know, this was the normal rate. But then let's say, you know, like 20 years out, right? Everyone is charging $60 an hour, but you're still stuck charging $30 an hour. You can't just suddenly inflate your rate by 100% for your poor current students. So you do have to make little changes over the years. And then there are books. New method books come out every, I would say, 5 to 10 years-ish. And you as a teacher will start finding new books that you click with better. Maybe your students will find a book and show it to you. I would encourage you to be flexible. Try out a new book if you see it and you like it. I wouldn't port everyone over to a new set of books all at once because I just don't really think that's really smart. You want to try it with one student first and take mental notes about which part of the books are really effective, which part of the books are not really effective. As a teacher, you want to have the time to figure out if you actually want to port everyone else over onto this new book that you found. And there you have it. Those are just 5 of the biggest realities of building a private music studio that I have experienced. Obviously, I have not covered everything. For example, helping your students find new instruments. I was going to include that in this video, but then I figured out that it was going to probably take a whole nother video just to talk about that. If you want that, please let me know in the comments below. If you guys are teachers yourselves, I would love it if you can comment below. Do any of these realities ring true with you and your experiences? Do you have other realities that you have run into that no one ever warned you about? Please leave it in the comments below. I would love if we can just share and encourage each other. If you like this video, make sure you give me a big thumbs up and hit subscribe for new videos every Saturday. If you want to click the bell, go ahead. That will give you a notification every time I upload a video. My last video is over there, and if you want to catch me during the week, my social media networks are down there. But otherwise, I will see you guys next week. Bye. If they are willing to pay an extra $5, whoa, it's getting really bright.